Morning, everyone. Morning. Welcome to our Harvest Family Festival. So once a year, we gather together to celebrate harvest, and I'll explain what that is in a little while. So first of all, we'll do the celebrations. And I don't think today we've got any birthdays or anniversaries, unless anyone's going to say they have. Any birthdays, anniversaries? Daisy? Ella? Ella, is it your birthday today? Your birthday's next Sunday, and how old are you going to be? 9. So happy birthday, Ella, for next Sunday, 9. That's brilliant. Any other celebrations? Sandra? Sandra has 2 celebrations. Thank you, Sandra. So we've got a really good testimony there of one of Sandra's family members, Helen, and how she's recovered from a very serious illness. So brilliant, thank you. Any other celebrations this morning? Yes, Natasha? Brilliant. Excellent. That's good news, Natasha. Thank you. So thank you for that. Any other celebrations this morning? Yes, Gail? Lovely. So Gail had a nice time with their family, a grandson, so that was really good. Any other celebrations? So we have one other celebration, which is glorious, but also a bit sad. So Gaynor, one of our past members, passed away yesterday. We think she was 97. So she had the most fantastic innings, and she was a wonderful person. And if you look up here, these banners, we've got 2 at the front and 2 at the back. She helped make those. That's really good. So we'll remember her. Excuse me, I'll be fine. Hey, let's pray. Father, we just thank you for all the things we can celebrate this morning. Father, we thank you we can come together and celebrate life and celebrate death. Father, we thank you this morning that Gaynor is in heaven with you, worshipping with the angels. Father, we thank you for the legacy that she leaves behind. And Father, we just pray for her family at this time. And ask Lord to be close to them. Father, we thank you that we can come together as family. We can worship together. Father, we just thank you for all the good things that you give us. Father, we thank you for good times with friends and good times with family. Father, we thank you we can worship together. And Father, we just thank you so much for the story of Helen, for the memory that she's got of all the illness she's brought her through, that you've brought her through. And now, Father, she celebrates that and she writes this book. And Father, we just pray that this book will bless so many people. And Father, we thank you for Natasha, Lord, and we thank you, Lord, for the injections that have really helped her health. And Father, we just ask, Lord, that she will continue to get better and that, Father, you will bless her. And Father, for all of us this morning, we thank you we can come together and celebrate harvest. We thank you, Father, for the food that we have on our tables. Father, we thank you for all the good things you give us each day. And Father, we just pray this morning that we'll worship you from the depths of our hearts. We ask this in your name, Father. Amen. Sorry, everyone, the emotional one goes again. Right, okay. Next bit. So I thought I'd just talk to you about harvest and what is harvest. And I think when we were at school, we used to learn about harvest quite a lot, and I don't think people do that now. So I just got a bit of an introduction. So I hope we've got a couple of slides to come up. Okay, so Harvest Festival. So this is from Food Fact for Life, which is an organisation that go into schools and talk about harvest and educate people. So next slide, please. Okay, so the history of Harvest Festival. So it started off in the UK, and it was always celebrated on the Sunday nearest to the harvest moon. So I'm hoping today we're on the Sunday nearest to the harvest moon, but if not, does it really matter? And in the past, celebrations used to begin on the 1st of August, when the first loaves of bread were harvested from the new wheat crop. And it actually originates all the way back to pagan times before being adopted by the church. So it went back even before church times. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so what traditions do we have at Harvest Festival? So we have a number of traditions. I suppose the most common one is the baking of harvest loaves. And if you go into some bakers, you'll see different loaves at this time of year where they've used the wheat from the harvest. Singing of songs about harvest. So we're going to sing a couple of harvest songs this morning. The creation of food baskets to be shared. So what we've actually got here is items for the food bank. So any items that you've bought today, they'll be donated to the food bank to support people locally. And also the arrangement of flowers. Sorry, I didn't get any flowers this morning. I should have asked you, Natasha, shouldn't I? But sometimes we have flowers at harvest as well. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, and it's not just celebrated in the UK. Harvest is celebrated around the world because of the importance of having enough food to eat. And we're very thankful, aren't we, to always have food on our tables and we can eat every day. And not all countries celebrate harvest in the same way. They might sell it in slightly different ways on different dates. They have different traditions. But our tradition is to celebrate and to share food with one another and to celebrate God. So that's a bit of a background about harvest. So let's just pray. Father, we thank you for all the good things you give us. We thank you that we have food on the table. And Father, we thank you we can remember today that all this food is given from you. Father, we thank you for all the farmers that work really hard throughout the year to make it possible for us to have food on the table. And Father, we just pray that the food we donate to the food bank this morning will be given to those that really need it. And we ask that they'll be blessed to receive these gifts. We ask this in your name, Father. Amen. Okay, we're going to stand and sing now. We plough the fields and scatter.
From heaven above, then thank the Lord, oh thank the Lord.
Father, we just thank you for your great love. Father, we thank you that it's manifested in so many ways all around us. Father, we just thank you for the wonder of creation. Father, we thank you when we look outside, we just see everything you've created. And Father, we thank you that when we look at each other, we recognize that we are created in your image. And Father, we thank you that you say it is good. Father, we just thank you for that blessing this morning. Amen. If you'd like to take a seat. So I'm going to read our Psalm 65. O God, it is right for us to praise you in Zion and keep our promises to you because you answer our prayers. People everywhere will come to you on account of their sins. Our faults defeat us, but you forgive them. Happy are those whom you choose, whom you bring to live in your sanctuary. We shall be satisfied with the good things of your house, the blessings of your sacred temple. You answer us by giving us victory, and you do wonderful things to save us. People all over the world and across the distant seas trust in you. You set the mountains in place by your strength, showing your mighty power. You calm the roar of the seas and the noise of the waves. You calm the uproar of the people. The whole world stands in awe of the great things that you have done. Your deeds bring shouts of joy from one end of the earth to the other. You show your care for the land by sending rain. You make it rich and fertile. You fill the streams with water. You provide the earth with crops. This is how you do it. You send abundant rain on the ploughed fields and soak them with water. You soften the soil with showers and cause the young plants to grow. What a rich harvest your goodness provides. Wherever you go, there is plenty. The pastures are filled with flocks and the hillsides are full of joy. The fields are covered with sheep. The valleys are full of wheat. Everything shouts and sings for joy. Amen. So we're going to stand now and sing some songs together. The first one is Mighty to Save. Everyone needs compassion.
Everyone needs compassion. Love. everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe.
Sing now, Waymaker.
I worship you.
Father, we just thank you that you do make a way. Father, where there are times when we can't see that way, Father, where we can't see the miracle that you're working out, Father, we just ask that you help us to keep calling out to you. Father, to keep calling on your name. And Father, as we look at the state of our nation, the state of our world, Father, we cry out that you will do a miracle. Father, we ask that you will make a way in people's lives where they're struggling financially with the crisis that's going on. Father, we ask that you will perform a miracle and make a way for the hate that is in Russia from that man, Putin, just to be taken away. Father, we pray that he will want to withdraw his troops and that war will be no more. Father, we pray for all those innocent people in Ukraine, all those people that have lost family members, that have lost their lives through no fault of their own. And Father, we just pray that you will do a miracle in that country, that Father, you will make a way out there, and that Father, we will see things change. Father, we just ask so much that your peace will be seen in this world. Your peace will be seen across our nation, in people's lives around us. And Father, we just ask that you would direct our paths and direct our steps to those people that we need to be in touch with, because Father, they need a touch from you. And Father, we just pray that you would touch people's lives and make a change in this world. And Father, we ask that you'll start with us. Father, break our hearts and give us that heart of compassion to follow you and to do your will. We ask this in your name. Amen. We're going to sing now, The Battle Belongs, and this is all about praying and really seeking God in our lives.
Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Brilliant. Yep. Yes, Father, we thank you that you do lead us through mountains and valleys. And Father, when we can't see a way round or a way over it, Father, you provide that way for us. And Father, we thank you in those real tough times that you take us in your arms and you just hold us close to you. And Father, I just pray this morning that anyone that just needs to be swept up in your arms, Father, that you'll embrace them and comfort them. And that, Father, they will know that whatever they face, that you love them so much and you're right there with them. Father, we thank you for testimony. We thank you for examples of people that have been there. And Father, share their story to encourage us. And Father, help us to share stories of encouragement to each other, that we can share where we've been and where you've taken us. And Father, we know that for all eternity, that one day we will be with you. And Father, we thank you that that's our destination, that's heaven with you, where we can stand and worship at your throne. Father, we thank you for access to your throne room. Father, we thank you that you cover us with that robe of righteousness. And we thank you that one day we will be with you forever and ever. Amen. Okay, now it's my favourite time. It's craft time. Yeah. So we've got some trays over here. I don't know if I'm giving out the trays. Someone, please. Mark, James, yeah. Bethany, thank you. So on the tray, there are some wreaths to colour in. There's some scratch art and there's something else to colour in, some leaves, I think. And there's also a word search on there if you'd like to do a word search. There's also some colouring sheets on the table. So if we just take 10 minutes, do some craft, have a chat with one another, it's a good time to socialise and share with each other. And then we can see at the end of the 10 minutes where we're up to. Okay, everyone. Sorry, we're going to have to move on, otherwise we will overrun. And I don't want to overrun. So, you can carry on making your craft activities through the rest of the service if you like. We can keep them till afterwards, it's fine. But hopefully you had a good chance to catch up with each other anyway, which is nice. So, what we're going to do now is watch a clip of the story today, which is the parable of the sower, which is obviously very apt for harvest. So, we're just going to watch this clip now.
Stories of the Bible. The parable of the farmer. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He healed many people from their sickness, performed many miracles like calming storms, and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
One day, Jesus went and sat beside the sea. A great crowd gathered around him.
Oh, hey, everyone.
So he got in a boat and told them many things in parables.
Okay, listen to this.
He told them this story. A farmer went out to plant some seed. As he scattered it across his field, some of the seed fell on a footpath where it was stepped on, and the birds came and ate it. Other seed fell on shallow soil among rocks. The seed began to grow quickly because the soil was shallow, but the plant soon wilted under the hot sun, and since it didn't have deep roots, it died. Other seed fell among thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants. Still, other seed fell on fertile soil. This seed grew and produced a crop that was 100 times as much as had been planted. When Jesus had said this, he called out, "Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand."
Yeah?
Later, the disciples came to Jesus and asked what this parable meant. Jesus said, "The farmer plants seed by taking God's word to others. The seed that fell on the footpath represents those who hear the message, only to have Satan come at once and take it away. The seed on the rocky soil represents those who hear the message and immediately receive it with joy. But since they don't have deep roots, they don't last long. They fall away as soon as they have problems or are treated badly for believing God's word. The seed that fell among the thorns represents others who hear God's word, but all too quickly the message is crowded out by the worries of this life and the desire for other things. And the seed that fell on good soil represents those who hear and accept God's word and produce a harvest of 30, 60, or even 100 times as much as had been planted."
Okay, so that was today's stories, and more on that in a bit. It's coming again. Okay, so what we're going to do now is have a quiz. So we're going to do this side versus this side. Phil, I forgot to ask, have you got a pen and paper? Thank you, Phil. Here's my resident scorer. Okay, so we'll start with this side, actually, shall we, today? Okay, so we've got 12 questions. So the first question to this side. Okay, so Harvest Festival is traditionally celebrated on which day of the week? Monday, Wednesday, Saturday, or Sunday? What do you reckon? Sunday, Saturday, Sunday? Sunday. Okay, so this side are going for Sunday, and the answer is... Hey, there we go. Sunday, well done. So 1 point to this side. So as you can see, I've done multiple choice for you to make it a bit easier. Okay, so a question for this side. The word harvest comes from the word harfest, which means autumn, August, amber, or auburn. So what do you reckon this side? Autumn, you're going for autumn? Okay, that side are going for autumn, and the answer is... Hey, autumn, well done. 1 point each. Okay, the next question to this side. Which of the following is not a harvest festival tradition in the UK? Singing harvest songs, creating food baskets, making mooncakes, and baking harvest loaves. Now, guess who makes mooncakes for harvest? What country? And America, yeah. China and America. Okay, so, brilliant. So, 1 point to this side. Okay, question four. Next question this side. Okay, Llama's Day. Who's ever heard of this? So, Llama's Day is on which day of the year? July the 3rd, September the 17th, October the 8th, or August the 1st? What do you reckon? I have no idea why they put this question in the quiz, but I thought it was quite interesting. You'd all Google Llama's Day later on to see if it actually exists. Okay, what date should we go for then? Okay, so we're going for October the 8th. Oh, unlucky, August the 1st. And why did we not know the answer to that question? Okay, so no points that time. Okay, next question for this side. So the Harvest Festival celebration celebrated in the UK is also known as All Hallows Eve, the Mid-Autumn Festival, Thanksgiving, or Independence Day. What do you reckon? Thanksgiving? Okay, we're going for Thanksgiving. Yeah, well done, point for that side, Thanksgiving. I thought Independence Day was quite a good option. Okay, next question for this side. So the harvest of which food is celebrated each year in a place in Italy? Not quite sure how you say that. Is it olives, grapes, wheat, or beetroot? What are we going for? You going for olives? Okay, olives are saying now. Do we go for olives? Hey, well done, it's olives. Brilliant. Okay, next question to this side. The Harvest Festival celebrated in Bali, Indonesia, is dedicated to which crop? Wheat, rye, barley, or rice? What do we reckon? Reckon it's rice? Okay, we're going for rice? Yep, well done. Excellent. Okay, next question for this side. Which of the following is the most grown cereal crop in the UK? So is it wheat, barley, rye, or rice? Going for wheat. Okay, let's see. Well done. Wheat is the right answer. Well done. Okay, next question for this side. Which of these is the name of a vehicle that harvests and threshes grain? So is it a plough, a combine harvester, a tractor, or a rotavator? I was waiting for someone to see the accent. Okay, someone just says that combine harvester. Yeah, well done. Okay, brilliant. Okay, next question for this side. What is the name of the building at which flour is made from grains? So is it a mill, a farmhouse, a flour barn, or a bakery? A mill. A mill? The answer is mill. Let's have a look. Yep, well done. Brilliant. 1 point. Okay, question 11 to this side. I think it's your last question. What is meant by gristing? Now, this could be interesting. Is it grinding the grains into flour, sieving the grains, harvesting the grains, or mixing different grains together? Ooh, what do we reckon? You reckon grinding the grains to flour? Okay, let's have a look. Oh, mixing different grains together. Did anyone know that? No. Okay, so no points. So this side, question 12. Which part of the grain is used to make white flour? Is it the wheat germ, the endosperm, the husk, or the stalks? Endosperm? Going for endosperm? Let's have a look. Hey, well done. So I think that's 5 points each, is that right? Correct. So I did put a tiebreaker up here, but I think I forgot to bring the answer. But I think I can roughly remember. I wrote it in my diary, and I thought I'd just transfer that later on to my bit of paper and forgot. But I think I can remember. So this will be the closest person to get to that number, okay? So how many farmers are there in the UK? So have a little think, how many you think, have a little, and then both tell me an answer, and we'll see who's the closest. No options. This is a free reign, so it'll be the closest person.
Okay.
No, how many farmers in general? How many farmers? Okay, you guys had a little discussion? Okay, so Stella, are you saying something? Stella's saying 100,000 on this side, and what about you guys this side? 200,000. Okay, that's pretty good, you know. The answer is 97,000. So well done to this side. Well done. That was really good. So Stella knows all about farming. I'm very impressed. Well done. That was really good. Brilliant stuff. Okay, we're going to go back to the story now. Yeah. I hope you enjoyed that bit of fun. All right. A bit of paper. So the parable of the sower. So we talked about the four types of soil. So the soil on there, so there was four different types, and that represents our hearts. So from Jesus' explanation of the parable, it was in Mark chapter 4, verses 15 to 20. So it talks about hard and dry soil, shallow and rocky soil, crowded soil, and soft soil and good soil. So what we're going to look at is the condition of our hearts, because our hearts can be these four things. So the first one is the hard and dry heart. So at verse 15 it says, "These are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them." So I was thinking, who have we seen in Mark's gospel with this kind of heart? And you could say it's the Pharisees, because they don't accept Jesus as their Lord. They oppose him as their enemy. The more Jesus speaks, the more he heals, the more he teaches, it seems the harder their hearts become. And I was thinking about this, and it's quite a scary place to be, isn't it, to have a hard heart? Because it's completely closed to Jesus. It's uninterested in hearing him, and therefore unable to hear him. And it doesn't matter how religious they appeared on the outside, it was their hearts that told the truth. Now, as we know, Satan has a million methods of taking good seed away and taking away God's word. And he's really good at distracting us from spending time with God. If we think about it, is the conversation on social media more interesting than prayer? Is Netflix better than nightly meditation on God's word? Are you tempted right now to check your phone, to plan your week, to make your grocery list, just to zoom out for a while? And where do you think that comes from? That comes from Satan, isn't it, trying to remove God's word from our hearts and from our lives? And then next we've got the shallow and the rocky heart. So verse 16 and 17 say, "These are the ones sown on rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. They have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away." We see this kind of heart in the crowds that followed Jesus, like Twitter followers that see he's trending. They jump on the bandwagon. They love him for his miracles, but leave him for his exclusive claims. They don't stick with him because their heart just isn't open enough. They say they believe, but they don't endure, proving they don't really believe. They're merely interested in the latest thing. And when following Jesus gets uncomfortable, inconvenient, when it becomes tough or risky, they leave because they didn't sign up for that hardship. And with this heart, things are good for a while. But because people don't always consider his word, they've never chewed on it and never spent time reading it, it's become shallow, like a spring garden in the hot sun. And when things get tough, we leave him for something else. When we follow Jesus, as soon as he no longer works for us, we look for something else that will. And this is the heart that's tried Jesus and found he's just all right, but not all right enough. And then there's the crowd and the anxious heart. And verse 18 and 19 says, "And others are the ones sown among the thorns. They are those that hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful." If I were to caution us from one of these first three kinds of heart, this is the one that I'd highlight today. I think it's the bad soil we in our context and our culture are most prone to. This kind of heart is just too crowded, has too many things at the same level of importance. It upholds social status, comfort and security, and personal desires alongside the things of God. It's the heart of anxiety, worried about things out of our control, because we've let so many different things control us. But here's what we need. We need Jesus as the sole ruler of our heart. And in his grace, all it takes to receive that freedom is openness to him. But it does mean total openness. It means we hold nothing back. It means we hand over all of our life to him. No hidden corners, no locked doors. If we will accept that, we will find the way to the only good type of heart that Jesus presents in this parable. The soft, open heart, the good soil that Jesus alone can create. So the fourth type of heart, the soft and open heart. So verse 20 says, "But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit, 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. This is the heart of Jesus' disciples. They accept his word. They follow him when it's tough. They stick with him when they don't understand. They draw near. They lean in. They want Jesus. And to them are given the secrets of the kingdom of God. They get not only knowledge of his kingdom, they get his kingdom. They enter the experience. The soft and open heart is the heart of every Christian, is the heart that has accepted Christ and listened to his word. So I guess the question this morning is, what kind of soil is our heart? Is it hard and dry? Is it shallow and rocky? Is it crowded and anxious? Or soft and open? Do we have a heart of faith or a heart of unfaith? And here's how we can know. We can look at the fruit. Not everyone in Christ will yield 100-fold, but all in Christ will yield something. It's the way we know the seed has taken root in our life. The seed sown in good soil bears fruit. Three soils are bad and one soil is good. And if it looks good on the surface, the fruit is all that matters. So how do we get the good soil? Do we get it by being a good person? If so, good by what standard? Do we get it by removing the rocks underneath? If so, how can we see down far enough? Do we get it by pulling out the weeds in our life? If so, how can we be sure we've got to the root? Self-care won't produce what we need. We can never, ever be good enough. We can never remove all the rocks. We can never pull out enough weeds. We need another way. We need Jesus. He's saying the power of the gospel is in his death. The power of the gospel is the seed planted in the ground. Jesus is not the only sower. He's God's seed. And the fruit we need grows out of his grave. Is a seed really that powerful? A seed is so weak, you can crush it. And that's what Satan thought he did to Jesus on the cross. But not one of his bones was broken. In his death, Jesus wasn't a crushed seed. He was a planted seed. He fell into the earth and he died. And 3 days later, his power was released. Now that is the secret of the kingdom. And when you see that, something happens deep inside. Your heart of stone cracks open to Jesus. And once he's inside, his word grows and grows. There is a power that comes into your life. It's the power of the seed, the power of the word of God, the power of the sower. And it has the power to transform the soil of mine and yours heart. And if we won't listen to that message, what will we listen to? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this parable you told. Father, we thank you that it talks about the condition of our hearts. And Father, we just ask this morning to seek your forgiveness. Father, we ask if there's things that have got in the way of life, if we've become too busy or anxious or worried. If, Father, our hearts have become hardened because of circumstances that have happened to us. Father, we just ask that your power will come down and transform our hearts. Father, we just pray that we will become that soft, open heart, that good soil that, Father, you can grow in. And, Father, we ask that we'll be able to see fruit in other people's lives and fruit in our lives because, Father, we've trusted in you. Because we've read your word, because Father, it's changed our life. Father, help us this week to go out with your word in our hearts, to speak to others about you. Father, transform us and change us. And Father, as we meet other people, may your power be evident in our lives. And may, Father, your power continue to change and transform lives of those around us. We ask this in your name, Father. Amen. So to finish now, we're going to stand and sing How Great Is Thou Art. How great thou art.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great. Joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great.
Some of the good things that you have given us. And Father, we just pray that this week will be a real week of a celebration of us spending time with you. We ask this in your name, Father. Amen. Everyone like to take a seat? There's one thing I forgot to do earlier. Did anyone notice? I forgot to do the notices. Because I got emotional. Okay, so we'll do the notices now. Okay, so this week we've got a chat on Zoom tonight. Yep, 7:30. So if you'd like to join and you haven't got the code, have a chat with Phil, want to give you the code. It's also house group week. So if you're in a house group, then please go along. Or if you'd like to join one, once again, have a chat with one of us. Okay, so on a Wednesday at the church, at 7:30, we have a beta group. So if you'd like to come along and find out more about Jesus and ask questions and have a time of fellowship, then please feel free to come down. Yes. Forgiveness. Learning to forgive ourselves. Okay. Okay, thanks, Natasha. Yeah, so forgiveness is this week, so thanks for that. Brilliant. Okay, also on Thursday at 4:30, Kenny is doing outreach in the local streets, walking around praying with people. So if you'd like to join him, then please come down. Okay, there's a couple of activities that are going on at the Baptist. So the first one is the light party. So this is an alternative to Halloween. So if you have children or no children that would like to go, they are more than welcome, but you just need to register first so they've got an idea of numbers. So that is on 31st of October, 4:30 to 6:30. And also, Christians Against Poverty, so CAP, an organisation that run courses and help people to try and help themselves through a financial crisis. So once again, the Baptists are running a course. If you know anyone that would be interested or you'd like to go along, once again, you're more than welcome. But once again, you just need to register. And I think it's great that we've got a church nearby in Ryslip that's willing to open up and let us go to their activities as well. So brilliant. Thank you. And shoeboxes. So the shoeboxes are due in by when, Gail? Okay, we can't remember the date. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, shoeboxes. So we've got some shoeboxes outside in the lobby and we've got some leaflets. So if you'd like to make some shoeboxes, you can do that. If you'd like to donate a shoebox online, you can do that as well. So then you don't need to physically do anything. They do it all for you. Like, is it £25, I think? £20? Can't remember. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because we have got a bag actually from last year, which has got pens and pencils and stuff in there. So we'll take those down. So if you've got any bits, yeah. Yeah, brilliant. Thanks, Al. So we're, probably 1 or 2 weeks' time, the deadline then. November the 9th. There we go. Brilliant. Okay, thank you, Gail. Excellent. And finally, if you would like a cup of tea, if you'd like a coffee and some biscuits and more chat, then please stay behind. Feel free to take any craft activities with you, any spare ones, any ones that haven't been done. I think there's more spare ones on the table. And thank you very much and have a good day. You may.